We've seen that something extraordinary lurks at the heart of the Milky Way galaxy, a supermassive black hole 4 million times the mass of the Sun. But even before this object was discovered, it was understood that some external galaxies have strange things going on in their nuclei. First evidence of this happened in the 1940s, when Carl Seyfert took images of external galaxies, especially spiral galaxies, that had incredibly bright nuclei. Far brighter than you'd expect from the star cluster at the center of those galaxies. These nuclei were not only bright, but they had intense amounts of ultraviolet emission, and often they were variable in their luminosity, variable on timescales of weeks. There's a simple argument based on light travel time that says that if any coherent object is varying on a particular timescale, it must be smaller than the distance light could travel in that timescale. So the Seyfert galaxies whose light output from the nucleus was varying on timescales of weeks must be smaller than light weeks across and have an enormous amount of radiation coming from that region. Seyfert also took spectra of these galaxies and showed that their centers had broad emission lines. The breadth of an emission line is a Doppler measure of how fast the gas was moving. Unlike the gas in orbit around the Milky Way disk, which has velocities of only a few hundred kilometers per second, the gas in the center of these galaxies was moving at speeds of thousands of kilometers per second, up to 10,000 kilometers per second. Something very exotic must have been driving these high gas speeds. Next, as infrared techniques were perfected in the 1970s, people noticed that the Seyfert galaxies also had intense infrared nuclei. Essentially, they had large amounts of electromagnetic radiation coming across the spectrum. In extreme cases, the luminosity of a Seyfert galaxy nucleus could vary by more than the entire light output of the Milky Way on timescales of a few weeks. A decade or so after Seyfert's work, radio astronomy came out of its infancy and started to measure populations of radio sources in the sky. The brightest of these radio sources were phenomenal in their radio output, far exceeding the radio emission from our own galaxy. As radio astronomers developed the technique to map out the radio emission, as opposed to just detect its intensity, they noticed that the radio emission often was not coming from the center or the nucleus. Sometimes it was coming from twin lobes of plasma at distances of up to 1 million light years away from the nucleus. Something was putting energy out and making it travel over these vast distances into intergalactic space. The mechanism for this radio emission was supposed to be synchrotron emission. The key diagnostic to indicate that it was synchrotron emission was the fact that the radiation is polarized, which means the particles are being accelerated in a coherent magnetic field. As this information accumulated in the 1950s and 1960s, people realized that the nuclei of many galaxies had extraordinarily energetic phenomena occurring. Essentially, plasma is somehow being ejected from these galaxies at speeds close to the speed of light, energies far beyond the reach of terrestrial accelerators. To drill down into the center of these external galaxies takes very high angular resolution. That resolution came to radio astronomy through the development of the interferometric technique. In optical astronomy, it came with the launch of the Hubble Space Telescope. Eventually, a hypothesis emerged to explain these phenomena. By analogy with the argument for the center of our own galaxy, it was quickly realized that a hugely dense star cluster could not possibly explain these various phenomena, especially the radiation at non-visible wavelengths like radio waves and X-rays. The hypothesis that emerged was of a gravitational engine, a supermassive black hole. As matter fell into the black hole, it was accelerated, and the accelerating particles produced enormous amounts of electromagnetic radiation across the entire spectrum, range of billions in wavelengths. The supermassive black hole is at the exact gravitational center of a galaxy. It's the gravity pit into which matter is falling, and therefore the black hole is presumed to have grown over time to reach the sizes currently seen in the universe, up to billions of times the mass of the Sun. Although a black hole is indeed black, as matter goes into its death spiral near the event horizon, it can release enormous amounts of energy. In principle, and in the theory, the efficiency of a gravitational engine can be quite high, 10 or 20% of the mass energy released. Remember that normal stellar fusion releases less than 1% of mc squared of the mass energy, so this is 10 or 20 times more efficient than stellar fusion. By the early 1960s, a zoo of active galaxies had been discovered. Starting with the galaxies that Carl Seyfert found in the 1940s, spiral galaxies with bright, luminous, variable nuclei. Adding to that, in the 1950s, radio galaxies found with plasma ejected far beyond the realm of the galaxy itself. And then through those decades, an increasing number of interacting or merging galaxies where something extraordinary seemed to be happening in the combined nucleus. Clearly, interactions was fueling activity in the nucleus. In the early 1960s, a young researcher called Martin Schmidt from Holland, but working at Caltech, took data with the 200-inch telescope at Mount Palomar. He took spectra of bright star-like objects that seemed to be associated with strong radio sources from the Cambridge surveys. It was unusual to find a star-like object associated with a radio source. The Sun and other normal stars have very weak radio emission. So what possible star could emit such intense radio waves? Well, it turned out they weren't stars at all. They were nearly star-like objects, quasi-stellar objects, that were actually at phenomenal distances from the Milky Way. Martin Schmidt solved this puzzle by noticing that the spectral features were those of normal elements like hydrogen and helium, but shifted to the red by extraordinary, unprecedented amounts, 10, 15, 20% in the spectrum. By noticing this, Schmidt made an amazing discovery. He discovered that there were compact galaxies at distances of billions of light years from the Earth that were emitting as much radiation as 1,000 galaxies. These objects, quasars, were marked by intense radio emission, by very broad spectral lines indicating gas in the nucleus moving at nearly relativistic speeds, and by a very strong ultraviolet emission beyond that expected from any stars. Clearly, this had to be non-thermal emission, something related to the synchrotron emission that gave rise to the radio activity. The first quasars were intense radio sources, and they were typically numbered by the 3C catalog, or the third Cambridge radio catalog. 3C48 and 3C273 were the first two quasars discovered. And while the compact radio emission was the telltale that led optical astronomers to the optical counterpart, it soon turned out that most quasars did not have strong radio emission. Non-thermal, optical, and ultraviolet emission could be present with no strong radio waves. The number of quasars grew by leaps and bounds in the 60s and 70s until catalogs contained thousands of them, and their distances approached 5 to 10 billion light years from Earth. As we look out in space, we're looking back in time. So when Schmidt and others made catalogs of quasars, he realized that they were tracking out the cosmic abundance of these sources. It turned out that there was a peak in the nuclear activity that leads to the quasar phenomena, occurring 3 to 5 billion years ago. Before that, quasars thin out in their density in space, and after that, the quasars appear to fade. It's speculated that the growth of quasars corresponds to the growth of their black holes, and they enter a rapid fueling phase. In the more recent universe, the amount of fuel available has reduced, so even though the black holes are now very large, they have nothing to eat, and so they do not shine brightly at radio or optical waves. Quasars peaked in both their numbers and in their intrinsic brightness about 8 billion years ago, and they've since declined by several orders of magnitude. Whatever is going on with the supermassive black holes, they are starved of fuel and mostly quiet. It's hard to visualize a quasar, a phenomenon so remote from terrestrial experience, but let's use a terrestrial analogy. Imagine you're flying in a helicopter far above the city of Los Angeles at night. Now, there are not as many lights in Los Angeles, streets, and houses, as there are stars in a galaxy. There's perhaps one light for every 100 stars in a galaxy, 100 million lights maybe. Imagine those lights are stars, and that Los Angeles is a gigantic galaxy that you're looking down upon. Imagine you go far above the Earth until the galaxy becomes small and difficult to see. The individual stars are not visible anymore, they're too faint. A quasar is a single source of light about 4 inches across at the center of the city, downtown Los Angeles, that shines with the same brightness of 1,000 times the entire city light. That is the quasar phenomena. That is the central source of radiation that was so extraordinary that it could be seen over distances of billions of light years. Once again, we see that a black hole does not have to be black. In the deep gravitational potential well of the center of a galaxy, there's plenty of material for a black hole to eat. The material, as it spirals in, either gas or stars eaten whole, releases enormous radiation in the gravitational engine at the edge of the accretion disk, converting 10 or 20% of the mass energy into pure radiant energy across the electromagnetic spectrum. In these terms, the Milky Way is a modest black hole that is eating modestly and so does not shine very brightly. Quasars are the most massive black holes, 100 million to 1 billion times the mass of the Sun, that are devouring material and emitting enormous amounts of radiation. Astrophysical simulations give us a pretty good idea of how quasars might operate. As with a star, when it collapses, the angular momentum is conserved. So the black holes at the center of the galaxy should be spinning, and they should have very strong amounts of angular momentum. When plasma, or gas, falls upon the black hole, it gets accelerated along the poles and escapes as a very high-energy relativistic plasma, twin jets pointing out into space. These jets are roughly, but not perfectly, aligned with the rotation axis of the galaxy that contains the black hole. Radio astronomers in particular have mapped out in exquisite detail the jets of plasma that pour out into space far beyond the visible edge of the galaxy to distances of 1 to 10 million light years into deep extragalactic space. The mechanism is understood whereby particles can be aligned in a jet. Think of it as an enormous nozzle working for the plasma that sits around the black hole itself. Astronomers used this simple model to make sense of the zoo of active galaxies that they found. In terms of this simple model, a quasar is an object where the jet is almost pointing exactly at us. Most jets, however, will be misaligned, so we see them at an angle. And those are the objects where radio observing shows twin jets pointing out across space. Occasionally, we see the galaxy right at its edge, and the black hole along its equatorial plane. The jets are then transverse in space and laid out perfectly on the sky in opposite directions. With the discovery of quasars, a fundamental question arose. Since the quasars exist at the center of fairly normal galaxies, does every galaxy harbor a quasar? Or does every galaxy go through a quasar phase? Since quasars are fairly rare, 1 per cubic gigaparsec of space, the likely speculation was either that quasar phenomenon is a rare occurrence in particularly massive galaxies, or that the quasar phenomena occupied a small percentage of every galaxy's life. Doing statistics on the number of quasars is hard to distinguish between these two scenarios. However, in the last decade, the evidence has tilted in favor of every galaxy having a quasar phase and every galaxy having a supermassive black hole, instead of some special subset of galaxies having supermassive black holes. Most of the work to demonstrate this came from the Hubble Space Telescope and its exquisite angular resolution to probe down to the heart of external galaxies. Astronomers used the imaging spectrographs on the Hubble Space Telescope and laid the slit down across the nuclei of other galaxies. The rotation speeds of the gas and stars near the center of the galaxies could then be mapped out. This is like a miniature version of the rotation curve that demonstrated dark matter in the Milky Way and other galaxies. Because these galaxies are hundreds of millions of light years away, Hubble Space Telescope's angular resolution is required to drill down into the central parsecs of these distant objects. What the astronomers see is very rapid gas motions close to the center. Then you can essentially use Kepler's laws to deduce how much mass must be in the central region to drive such rapid gas motions. Very quickly, it became clear that only a supermassive black hole could be so centrally concentrated. There is too much mass in too small a volume for it to be a star cluster. It's a similar argument to the one used for the Milky Way, but these black holes are hundreds or thousands of times more massive. Excitingly, over a period of a decade, using large amounts of Hubble Space Telescope time, astronomers and various teams showed that every nearby galaxy harbors a supermassive black hole. But most of those supermassive black holes are not actively fueling, and so they do not show the enormous radiation across the electromagnetic spectrum of the typical quasar. The quasar stage is a rare stage of a galaxy's life, lasting perhaps 10 million years out of a 10 billion year lifetime of the galaxy. There also appeared to be some regularity to the nature of the black holes in galaxies. The black holes didn't have masses that were unrelated to the properties of the galaxies that contained them. In fact, there was a strict relationship, linear, between the mass of the supermassive black hole and the mass of the old stars in the galaxy. For the Milky Way, the old stars would be in the bulge, about a billion solar masses. For the most luminous galaxies, giant ellipticals, there are maybe 1,000 times more old stars, so the mass in the stars is 1,000 times larger. And correspondingly, the mass of their black holes is 1,000 times larger. The current record holder is a black hole about 10 billion times the mass of the Sun. It's extraordinary. Nature apparently knows how to make black holes with 9 orders of magnitude variation in mass, from the death of simple massive stars to the giant beasts at the heart of elliptical galaxies. More speculatively, astronomers have even pieced together the mass spectrum between solar mass or 10 solar mass black holes and the million solar mass black holes we see in normal spiral galaxies. Globular clusters apparently have black holes of 1,000 or 10,000 solar masses. So literally every part of this spectrum is now filled in by observation. Because of the quality of the Hubble Space Telescope data, the evidence for the existence of supermassive black holes is almost as good as the evidence for stellar mass black holes. And while they are extraordinary objects, supermassive black holes are in an interesting situation because it turns out that the size of the event horizon scales linearly as the mass. So the largest black holes have very large event horizons, and the mean density within the event horizon for a very massive black hole is not much denser than water. This is a black hole, but the state of matter is not unfamiliar to us in terms of density. Also, these are black holes where if one were near enough to us, the center of our galaxy is clearly the nearest place, we could venture in without being ripped apart by the tidal forces of gravity. As with stellar mass black holes, no one knows what's inside the black holes that every galaxy creates, and we may never know. The theory of active galaxies is not nearly as well developed as the theory of stars. We simply don't know in detail how they work. But a general landscape has been put together where there are two fundamental parameters that control how they behave and their evolution. One is the mass of the black hole itself. It's assumed that the mass of the black hole grows by steady fueling as it devours gas and dust near the center of the galaxy, and occasionally by mergers, where the black holes at the center of each galaxy coalesce. Black hole mass is one parameter. The second parameter relates to the fueling or accretion rate, which says how efficiently the black hole is converting gravitational energy into radiant energy that we can see with our telescopes. As with black hole mass, there's a range in fueling efficiencies. Some black holes, like the one in our galaxy, is nearly starved of fuel, and so does not shine very brightly. Others, like the black hole in the giant elliptical galaxy M87, are devouring enormous amounts of gas and stars whole, and they're radiating with phenomenal luminosities. It turns out that the supermassive black hole at the heart of the Milky Way is not unique. With observations made by the Hubble Space Telescope and other ground-based observatories, it's been shown that a supermassive black hole lurks at the center of every galaxy, with a mass proportional to the mass of old stars in the galaxies. They range, therefore, from the Milky Way, with a few million times the mass of the Sun, up to giant ellipticals, with black holes billions of times the mass of the Sun. The key attribute in whether the black hole shines brightly across the electromagnetic spectrum is how much it is fueling, or how fast it is eating, stars and gas available near the center of the galaxy. AGN, or active galaxies, vary widely in their fueling rates, so some black holes are dim or dark or barely visible, and others are phenomenally luminous and visible across 10 billion light years.